Hello everyone, today we are going to start discussing OpenGL programming in more detail. So we are going to look at one of the tutorial programs, which is tutorial 2, that draws a color cube, and we will try and dissect it in as much detail as we can and try to figure out how does it work. So where we left off in the previous lecture is with this view of our OpenGL application program, that data flows from the application program to the frame buffer and it gets converted from vertices to fragments on the way. And the way this happens is that our application program loads this geometry data onto the GPU. Then each one of these vertices in the geometry data is acted upon by a vertex shader. Then they go through the rasterizers after they have been assembled into primitives, and the rasterizer generates fragments. And the fragments then are acted upon by the fragment shaders, which finally results in pixels on the screen. Now, what steps should the application program go through to enable this? So these are roughly the steps. So there are four steps. We get the geometry data and we make it available to the application program as input. Then we create buffer objects in OpenGL and we load this data into those buffer objects, and those buffer objects get shipped to the GPU memory. Then we create shader programs. So a shader program will consist typically of at least one vertex shader and one fragment shader. And then finally we will connect the variables in our shader programs with the buffer objects so that the variables can get their values from the data that we loaded into the buffer object. And then we just sort of execute the render call so that the processing starts. And intertwined with all this is how we open Windows, how we handle keyboard and mouse input, and how do we check whether we have the appropriate OpenGL version, and some helper functions to help us deal with various kinds of data, right? So the first four are the primary steps, and the next set of things are sort of secondary operations that we need to do to get this entire thing going. So we will look at each one of these steps and in turn, right, one at a time. So just to remind you, the geometric objects that are present in OpenGL, we have a vertex, and a vertex is nothing but a location in space defined in some coordinate system. The vertex can have various attributes. So this is OpenGL terminology. The vertex can have various attributes. One of these attributes is, of course, the coordinates of the vertex. A color is another coordinate of a another attribute of a vertex. And then it can have various other attributes like normals and texture coordinates that we'll talk about later. All vertex data that goes into OpenGL must be stored in what are known as vertex buffer objects. And we will see how to create these vertex buffer objects, or VBOs. And these vertex buffer objects can organize this data, that is the positions and the colors and so on, in various forms. And exactly the manner in which it is organized is stored in what is known as the vertex array object. So you can have a set of VBOs being referred to by one VAO, or like separate VBOs referred to by separate VAOs. So VAO is a vertex array object, and we will see how both of these are specified and why they must be specified. But in modern OpenGL, which is OpenGL 3.3 plus, both of these things have to be specified so that the GPU gets access to our geometry data. Now I just want to make a short aside, is that the primitives that you can draw in OpenGL are points, lines, and triangles. With lines, you can either draw lines or line strips or line loops, where if you give it a set of four coordinates and you say GL lines, then it will take consecutive points, non-overlapping. So from V0, V1, V2, V3, it will take V0, V1 to be one line, V2 to V3 to be another line. If I say instead a line strip, then for the first line, it will take the first two points. The next line, it will take one of the earlier vertices and one of the newer vertices, and so on. But it will not join the last vertex and the first vertex. In GL line loop, it will also join the last vertex and the first vertex. So that is the difference between a line. And so this is a line strip and this is a line loop. In GL triangles, you can see that if I give it a set of vertices from V0 to V8, it will take the first three and it will form a triangle. Considering that these vertices are arranged in the triangle in anti-cyclic or counterclockwise order. Okay. Similarly, it will take V3, V4, V5 and assume that they are in this order. And V6, V7, V8. Okay. Now this ordering is important because OpenGL is going to assume this order, and then when you ask it to compute normals, it is going to take the cross product of the edges of the vertices to get normals for the faces. So if your specification, if your data has vertices listed in the opposite order, then you will get opposite facing normals that will cause problems later in lighting. So please ensure that when you list vertices for a triangle, they are given in counterclockwise order. Okay. So these are GL triangles. Similarly, you have GL triangle strip where you have V0, V1, V2, and then the next triangle is formed by V1, V2, V3, and then the next one is formed by V2, V3, V4, and so on. And triangle fan is that the first vertex is common and everything else joins to the triangle. So whenever you use triangle strip or triangle fan, you should refer to a diagram like this and figure out that you are getting the ordering of the vertices right, because this is how the triangles are formed. Now earlier versions of OpenGL till about OpenGL 2.1 had also these other primitives, quads and quad strips and polygon. Now these are deprecated, so we will not use these. You will only use lines and triangles. So let us start looking at this demo program. So I just want to make sure that you understand where it is in your repository for the tutorial. So if you just look at, so this is the tutorial code from tutorial 2. So this is the color cube tutorial, and we will start inspecting what these lines are doing. So the first few lines are reasonably straightforward. We are just specifying for OpenGL what are the vertices that are going to make up our triangles. So here you can see that we say that we have 36 vertices. That is because we are doing some repetitive specifications. We are saying that there are three vertices per triangle, two triangles per face. So three and three, you need six. And then there are six faces, so 6 × 6, there are 36, right? So that is how we got 36. So we are actually repeating vertices in our list of vertices. This is not the most efficient way of doing it, but this is how it is written in this program. So the tutorials are just to give you an example, right? They are no way claiming that this is the only way to do things, or this is the best way to do things. It is just showing you a way of doing things. So feel free to take the tutorial code and modify it. If you think you can make it better, please go ahead and modify it, make it more efficient, or change it to suit your purposes if you are doing something else. Okay. So we have eight vertices. So we define this vertex positions eight. Now look at the type is GLM VEC4. So this is what we use GLM for these convenience types. So VEC4 is a four vector. So every vertex that we define has X, Y, Z, and this miscellaneous fourth coordinate, which for now will always be 1, right? So we will study about homogeneous coordinates in the next set of lectures when we start doing transformations, and then we will figure out what these represent. But for now, it does not matter. You can just assume that these are points in 3D space and leave this fourth point as 1. When you want to consider points in 2D space, you can just be bothered about X and Y and set Z to 0 and leave the fourth coordinate as 1. So that will work with for 2D coordinates. But they are internally stored as four vectors. So we are using GLM VEC4 for this purpose, and we have defined an array of 8 such vectors, and these 8 vectors give you the corners of this cube that you are trying to draw. Now for each corner, we have another array which stores for each corner a color. And here the four components are R, G, B and alpha. So R, G, B are the red, green and blue channel, and alpha is the opacity. So 1 means that you are opaque, and 0 will mean that you are transparent. Okay. So now how are we forming the quad? So far we haven't written any OpenGL code. So we are just specifying our input data. So now we have this helper function called quad. And what this does is that it creates these two other arrays, v underscore colors and v underscore positions, and fills them up according to some index for the triangle. So we will see how quad is used, because finally we have this function called color cube, which says quad 1032. So when you call it with 1032, what does it do? It goes here and substitutes 1032 for ABCD, and you can see that what is happening, it is picking up the corresponding elements from the colors and the positions arrays that we had defined earlier, and it is forming triangles. Okay, so it forms two triangles. So the first three form one triangle and the next three form another triangle. So the positions are for the positions of the triangle, the colors are for the colors of the vertices of the triangle, and together they will form one face of the cube. Okay, so in the color cube function we have 6 quad calls, so this forms the 6 faces of the cube. And what has this done? This has put in these v underscore colors and v underscore position arrays a list of vertices and their corresponding colors, arranged in the form of triangles, where every triangle belongs to a face of the cube. Now we are going to load this geometry into our buffers. Okay, so if we go back to the tutorial code on GitHub that is given to you, then you will find that so we have looked at the code up to this point, up to color cube. Then if you come down, you will see this init buffers GL function, right? And we are now going to look at this part of the data where we are going to load the data into arrays. So load the data into buffers. So there are two kinds of buffers. One is the vertex buffer object that just stores the arrays that contain the geometry data and the color data. And so this is like one buffer that's going to store both this data. And then there is going to be the vertex I'm sorry, it says here attribute object. This should have been a vertex array object. So on the slides, this is given correctly. So it should be a vertex array object. That is what is a VAO. The VAO will store for you what attributes is present at what location in the vertex buffer object, right? And we will see an explanation of this. So how do you do this? You start off by initializing a VAO. So you say GLU and VAO, gen vertex array. So you are asking OpenGL to generate internally a vertex array and return its ID to you in this variable VAO. Okay. And when you say GL bind vertex array, it binds this vertex to your current context. So whatever you do after this, that is in relation to vertex buffer data, that will get stored inside this VAO, right? The attributes of that will get stored inside this VAO. So this is just ask. So the gen vertex array just asks OpenGL to give you a reference to the VAO. The bind vertex array makes that VAO current. So this VAO is the active VAO now. After you have done this, you must load the data into a VBO. So for the VBO, you do the same thing. You again call GL gen buffers, like you had called gen vertex arrays for VAO. You call GL gen buffers and you ask for one VBO. And then you bind that buffer to the current context, and then you load data into that buffer. Okay. So I will show you the code directly from the tutorial page. Just hang on. So if you see here, you have written the VAO commands and the VAO has been made current. Then what you are doing is that you are asking OpenGL to return to you one vertex buffer object, and its ID is returned to you in VBO. Then you are binding that VBO to the current context. So you are making this the current buffer to be used, right? GL array buffer is just telling OpenGL that VBO is a vertex buffer object. There can be various other kinds of buffers that OpenGL might have that you can bind with this bind buffer command. So this is just telling OpenGL what kind of buffer you are binding. Then you are going to load data into it. So first we call GL buffer data and we say that we are going to work on a buffer object which is of size, which is the sum of the sizes of these two lists, which are V positions and V colors, lists or arrays, whatever you want to call them, right? And this is going to be used for something that is not going to change during the duration of the program. So we are going to draw this cube, and the shape of the cube, the vertices are not going to move, so the shape of the cube is not going to change. So we say that that this is for GL static draw, right? If I change the vertex locations changing the positions of the vertex, then I will say GL dynamic draw here instead of GL underscore static draw. Okay. Now I will, so this just allocates a buffer of this size. Now I have to load the data into this buffer. So I'm using this GL buffer subdata command where I'm saying again that this is an array buffer, right? And these are automatically all acting on the buffer that I have bound here, right? So I don't have to again and again say that use this buffer that VBO refers to. It always refers to the current buffer. So I am acting on a buffer of this kind, whatever is the current buffer of this kind, start at the position 0, go on till positions, that is the size of V underscore positions, and copy from this position to that position everything from this array. Okay, so for if there are say 10, so we have 36 vertices, so from 0 to 35 it will copy 36 vec4s, which will be the positions of these vertices. Now then it says start from the 36th location and go on till the size of the color, which is 36 more, right? So from 36 to 71, go on and copy whatever was there in the V colors array. So now copy the 36 colors. So in the VBO, it first copies the 36 positions, then it copies the 36 colors. So we have arranged the vertices and colors one after the other. This is one way of arranging. You might also interleave them. So you might store one vertex, then its color, then another vertex, then its color, and so on. It does not matter. Whichever way you store it, you have to refer to it in the same way in your shader program later. So we will figure out how that is done in the next couple of slides. Okay. So by doing this, we have loaded our data into a vertex buffer object, and we have put it inside a put that vertex buffer object or linked that vertex buffer object to a vertex array object. Okay, so the use of the array object might not be exactly clear at this point in time. So I highly recommend that you look at the learningopengl.com tutorial. And if you go to this left hand side pane, just click on getting started and click on hello triangle and try and go through this entire explanation. Okay, so they have a very good explanation of what is the vertex array object doing for you. Okay, and I will just show you briefly here their explanation. So this is what it is doing. So this is your VBO, right? So your VBO might contain, say, only positions. You might have another VBO that is position color, and so on. Now, the vertex array object has, say, attribute 0 for your vertices is position. So attribute 0, the starting pointer will point to the beginning of VBO 1, if this VBO 1 has been defined under VAO 1. On the other hand, VBO 2 might have been defined under VAO 2, then here, and it has two attributes. Here the first attribute will point to the positions, and then they are linked by, because they are at a fixed stride. And the second attribute will point to colors, and then they are linked by a fixed stride. So you see that whatever attributes you store for a vertex, the VAO remembers where they start in the VBO and points to that. So when you want to draw, you only have to make this VAO current. So you just bind to this VAO and you can give your draw call, and it will automatically pick up the data from the corresponding VBO. You do not have to do any extra work. So this is the draw call. We are saying use program. So this is the shader program that has to be used. This we will talk about in a bit. Then you just bind the vertex array, and then you call your draw function. Okay, so at drawing time, you do not have to bother with making the VBOs current, making sure that data is in correct order, referred to in correct order, and so on. Once you have set it up, that's it. The VAO now remembers it. Now you can go ahead and do other stuff in your code. Just before drawing, enable that VAO, bind it to the current context, and you are done. Okay, so we will continue our discussion with how do we link this data with the shader code next. Okay, so we have to create a shader program, and we will continue our discussion of this program of the application program by looking at the shaders next.